Hey, can we just celebrate something small together? Here's a small thing. I heard there was a baptism today. Was that today already? That's awesome. Yes. Paris, oh yes, so awesome. I love this kid, so great, way to go. And then also, man, at the Pasco campus today, got to pray with somebody, first time in their life, they decided they wanted to start following Jesus, and that was just a thrill. And listen, every single one of those stories is a huge win in God's world and for New Vintage Church, and you're a part of that. Isn't that great? That's got to be the thing we celebrate the most, when somebody finds life in Jesus. And man, good to be here and good to be with you guys. I'm going to do the final of four sermons on rest for your souls. And it's been a great series. People have responded really, really well to this, and it's kind of met a need for people. And I got to be honest that it's been hard for me in a way, because I'm not a restful person. I'm a go person. I'm like, let's get up, let's keep moving. I want to stay busy. And so I've actually begun to practice some of the things I've been preaching. That's a good idea. Practice what you preach. But literally trying to learn how to have Sabbath rest and how to really allow God to take charge and not have to run everything and in my life. And so it's been good. And today is part four. Pastor Austin did a great job last weekend talking about anxiety and how that can affect. Now God wants to heal that. And if you missed last weekend, you can catch that on YouTube. But I want to jump back in, and here's where I'm going to go. I'm going to just put all the cards on the table. I'm going to talk to you today about an idea that God cares about your soul, and that he wants to, like, if you could say this on the inside of you, if you're thirsty, if you're feeling parched or dry in your soul, God wants to personally give you a drink of water for your soul. He wants to refresh you. And so we're going to dive into that today. And I want to go to the scripture. We've been kind of bouncing the messages out of this, out of Jesus' words, each of these weeks. And here it is. Jesus said, "Come to me, all of you who are weary and you carry heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you. Let me teach you, because I'm humble and gentle at heart, and you'll find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy to bear, and the burden I give you is light." And ladies and gentlemen, listen, if you ever miss a Sunday and you just need a good sermon, just open up Matthew chapter 11, verse 28-30. Read this and just go, ah, God is so good. Jesus wants to, he makes an incredible claim here. He's literally at a festival, at a party, and he goes, "Hey, I know you've all had a lot to drink, a lot of food, a big party out here, everybody's celebrating. I got something to offer. If you're still weary on the inside, you're carrying a heavy burden, I'll give you rest for your souls. Come to me." It's quite a claim. And it's quite a contrast. What he offers is not just refreshment, but rest and restoration for our souls. And I think that's amazing. And I love that Jesus can do that. Man, when I was a kid growing up, we grew up in Milwaukee, Oregon. Me and my sister, Katie. She's got a great family, too, by the way. And my other sister, Amy, and we had, yeah, we won't say anything about you. No, I'm just kidding, Miles. It's my brother-in-law. And things in your childhood impact you as an adult, for sure. And one of the things that impacted me is, you know, my dad was in construction. And so we went through the late 70s and early 80s, and there was an economic crash. And construction was really rough. And he didn't get paid a lot. He worked a lot, but didn't get paid all the time. And we didn't always have a lot of food available in the house. And man, when you're a kid and you open up the cabinets and there's no boxes of cereal and no jars of peanut butter, it's like, because groceries are life for a kid, right? And so you kind of panicked a little bit. And God came through and God did miraculous things for us. We didn't always get to eat the things that we wanted to eat, but God kept us going and got us through that season, because God is a faithful God. But because of that, I think that it's affected me as an adult, where I get this profound, overwhelming sense of joy when I go here to Costco. Like, I just, this is real. This is real for me. This is my life. I get excited and I go, yes. Like, I just love that. And there's two phases of the joy in my soul. Phase one is going into Costco. The floor is always polished. There's always just like mountains of everything, and like, you don't just grab a peanut butter jar, there's like six of them attached, you know. It's like Lincoln Logs of peanut butter, and I'm still living on razors I bought in 2012, And it's just, I love it. It's just, there's an overwhelming sense of that. And then the second phase of my joy comes when I get home and I go to restock the shelves and put the things back. So when we run out of stuff and I get to put things on the shelf, there's something that literally does something good inside of me. I just go, there's going to be peanut butter for years. You know what I mean? Like, I just, there's that sense, and there's something good about that. And one of the ways that Jesus gives rest to our souls is by restoring or restocking our souls. When they're thirsty, when they're parched, when there's empty spaces in the shelving of your life, what Jesus wants to do is he wants to actually restock and restore, rejuvenate. He wants to just put things back that have gone down to the last. That's how good he is, and he wants to do that for us. One of the ways he does that is through restoring our souls. King David, one other scripture I want to use as a bounce off point today is King David really understood this. He's one of the kings of Israel several hundred years before Jesus comes in to the scene in Israel. And King David writes this with such an amazing awareness of how good and who God is. He says, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures, and he leads me beside still waters, and he restores my soul, and he leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. The Lord is my shepherd." The interesting thing is David was actually a shepherd, and he took care of sheep. But in this song that he's writing and singing, he says, "God, I'm not going to lead my life like I lead the sheep. You're going to be the shepherd, and you're going to lead me. And I'm going to trust you to take care of my needs, to lead me in green pastures so that I'm fed, to lead me by still waters so I can drink." But then David takes it the step further and he goes, you know, when you take care of me, you do more than just take care of me. You restore my soul, like on the inside. And I love that. It's an amazing thing about God that he can do that. That's really something that only God can do. You can do a lot of things to try to relax and unwind and get some rest, but only God can really, truly restore your soul when it's weary and broken. You've been carrying heavy things. So this is the title of my message today, if you like that kind of thing. What are you drinking? You might be the most interesting man in the world, and you may not. No, listen, but when you do, what are you drinking? What is it that fills your soul in moments of weariness, when you're fighting off depression, when you're stressed out about the job, when you're wondering about the relationships and if you got it right and the habits that you have? What is it that you're drinking for your soul? And I think Jesus wants to offer a better drink than what most of us are drinking. I have kind of three main thoughts to just set out my outline today. And here's the first thought is that the opening lines of what Jesus said, when he says, "Come to me and I will give you rest for your souls." We can't skip over those opening words. Those opening words are so key. Come to me. In other words, the power in what he's saying is so profound, and most of us miss it in our spiritual journey. Like, we go, I'm going to go to church. I'm going to download a sermon podcast. I'm going to even download a new worship album. But Jesus is saying, hey, above all those things, come directly to me. Like, go to Jesus, and he will restore, and you'll find rest for your souls. Like, Jesus wants to personally engage with you. Lisa and I are going to go on sabbatical here at the end of this week, and pretty excited about it. Going to have some time off that our elders have talked about this for us since the beginning of last year. And so we'll be back in August. Can I just tell you, church is going to be probably better when I'm gone, not because I'm gone, but like, our team just steps it up a notch, and it's going to be some of the funnest times, and it's going to be awesome. You know what I would love as a pastor while we're on a rest and kind of just practicing some of the things? I would love to come back to the church having more people in it. Come on, say amen. Don't miss church, and you just come in. There's more work. Like, you're singing louder when I walk in August. Come on. I would like there to be more money given to the cause of the kingdom. Say amen to that. If you said amen, that's on you. Come on, that's good. And I would like more people to get saved this summer than any summer we've ever had. Like, I just think God can build his church. It's not dependent on a person. But I just tell you that we're excited that we get to go take some time to rest. I'm I told myself I'm going to learn how to play acoustic guitar. I'm going to read a lot of books. I'm going to go to Costco. I'm going to watch all the Star Wars movies. I don't know. Take naps. It's going to be a great, great time. We're going to rest and rejuvenate. One of the things that I've learned, though, is that all those things are going to be good for us. But those things cannot replace and aren't the thing that's going to rejuvenate my soul. What I'm most looking forward to, and this is the honest truth, not as a pastor, just as a person, I'm most looking forward to having some extra time to spend with Jesus. Like, I'm getting excited about, I think Jesus is excited to see me. He's like, you know, and it's like, I know him, you know, and I'm going to do that. I long to be with him and to spend time with Jesus. And I think all of us in our life, it's something that we actually internally, we know we crave that, but sometimes we substitute actually being with Jesus by being at church. Now, I'm not saying don't come to church and go be with Jesus. Do it all, right? But you could come into this building and miss out on Jesus. Like, Jesus wants to touch your soul personally. Ah, so good. I love that the Bible has this great description of who God is in a couple places in Scripture, but in Psalm 71, David, again, he writes about God, and he knew he was so close to God. And he said this, he said, God, you are the lover of my soul. And I just think that's amazing. I just want to tell you today that God loves your soul. He knows you, and he loves who you are. He can see everything that's going on the inside of you. Every doubt, every struggle, every good moment, every time you try to do something great for God, he sees it all, and he knows, and he cares about your soul, and he wants to restore you, and he wants to do that work himself personally in your life. Isn't that great? I hope this is like drinking water, just hearing about how good God is. Here's some famous people and things they said about Jesus. Blaise Pascal, he said, Jesus is the center of all, the object of all. And whoever does not know him knows nothing aright, either of the world or of himself. Listen, if you're still at the center of your universe and calling all the shots, everything in your life is going to get messed up because you're messed up and I'm messed up. But if Jesus is at the center, it begins to order every part of our lives. Hans Denick said, the means to know God is Christ, whom no one may know unless they follow after him with their life. Like, there is a cost to following Jesus. He goes, hey, come to me and I'll restore your soul, but I want your whole life in exchange for this. But it's worth that. And then Larry Crabb, who's an incredible author and a counselor, he said, our passion for Jesus is the only passion that will not destroy us. Listen, in your moments of weakness, when you get home and you're tired, you've been through a long week and you're stressed out and you just go, I'm going to watch 4 seasons of something on Netflix, Uber Eats, order in and all that. And you're just like, I just need, and you just like veg out. Can I tell you that eventually in those moments, whatever it is for you, that in those moments, you're going to develop a passion for that thing. And that can be good or bad. If in those moments you find some relaxation, but you really turn to Jesus and go, Lord, I'm going to watch just 1 season tonight of whatever the show, I want you to pour into me. I'm telling you, your passion for Jesus will not destroy you, but it'll bring life to you. And so you need to develop that. I took my car into the shop this week to get the oil changed. And it's amazing how you get one thing fixed and they tell you how many thousands of dollars your car really needs, you know, and all of that. But I was in there and in the waiting room, for the surgery, they had on TV, and there was this show on with these two ridiculously good-looking twin brothers that restore homes. Have you seen this show? All the ladies are like, yeah, I know what you're talking about. Exactly. I'm listening now. I think it's Drew and Jonathan Scott. Does that ring a bell? Ladies and me. Yes, you're like, how do I hire them? I need to fix a window pane. All right. I'm watching that, but it's on like silent, so there's some subtitles. One of the interesting things that said on this one project, it said restoring is cheaper than replacing. And you know what happens in our lives sometimes is we think that because we're so broken, we're so aware of what's going on in our souls, we just think God would rather replace me with somebody else. And God's going, no, I want to get in and it's better. I want to restore you, not replace you. Like God actually wants to do some fixing. God does his best work in the dregs of our bottom of the barrel moments. It's really what he's unafraid to get in the mess with us and the details. And it's where he does his finest restorative work. He wants to restore our souls. So good. So if the analogy fits that our souls are thirsty for God, I think that makes sense. Augustine of Hippo, the city, not the animal, he said, "Thou hast made us for thyself, O Lord, and our heart is restless until it finds rest in thee." There's something in your soul that you'll never find rest in whatever you're drinking, whatever shows you're watching, however you numb the pain. It won't rest your soul until you find rest in God. And David said this super clear. He said, "My soul thirsts for God, the living God." Like not just any God, not any religion, not just like God, if you're alive and you're there and I believe you are, then I want to meet with you, the living God. I need to connect with you. And there's something in our souls that thirsts for the living God, for the life of Jesus. And listen, Jesus is either dead or he's alive. If Jesus is alive, then he has the power to meet with us, speak to us, heal us, restore our souls. And our souls are thirsty to encounter God and not some cheap counterfeit or some version that's already been chewed up by somebody else. Listen, you need to go to Jesus directly is what I'm trying to say today. I was in Bible college and it was an ironic moment when I saw the newspaper and it was in Taco Bell. Because typically I think of newspapers as being at a little higher end joints than Taco Bell. But, you know, we all love our Taco Bell once in a while. So I'm in college and I'm there, and I'll never forget the newspaper. There was one of the storms that was named after some evil person or something, I don't know. And there was a picture of the flood, and I think it was in Louisiana. And you could see the tops of homes and cars, and it was just this massive flood area. And I'll never forget the headline. That's what struck me. And the headline said, "Water, water everywhere, yet not a drop to drink." And literally in that storm, people were isolated and they were dying of thirst, literally dying because they couldn't get clean water. And yet they're in the middle of a flood. And it's this incredible picture of maybe our lives today that your life has so much information and your life has so many streams of content coming in that there's an overwhelming flood of noise and things that want to try to help you with your soul. They'll say, hey, if you just do this. Like, have you ever noticed, if you go on Facebook, you can scroll. There's not a bottom. You don't get to the end. It just keeps going. I like Apple News. And sometimes I'm just like, and I just keep scrolling. And I'm like, I'm reading news from like 97. How did I get down here? You know, and like there's just an endless. And then people call, television shows. Netflix has a constant barrage of new things coming out. Now there's going to be Apple TV, Disney TV, other TV streaming services, and there is a flood. But none of that will quench the thirst that you need inside your soul. You've got to be aware that God is the fountain that we need to go to drink from. I'm going to read a couple scriptures to you today to try to just drive this home and let you see that this is God's heartbeat for us, man. He loves us. In one of the places where King David writes in Psalms 107, he's doing a little history lesson. He says, "Some wandered in the wilderness and they were lost and they were homeless. They were hungry and thirsty. They nearly died. Lord, help," they cried out in their trouble. "And he rescued them from their distress. He led them straight to safety, to a city where they could live. Let them praise the Lord for his great love and for the wonderful things he's done for them. He satisfies the thirsty, and he fills the hungry with good things." I love that story, that of all the things that they could talk about, how they got rescued from the situation, hunger and thirst are in there. Listen, God knows that you're thirsty. He sees our souls. He's the lover of your soul. He cares about you. And the reason this I think, story in particular probably happened is because they weren't just complaining about God. They actually went to God and they said, Lord, help us. Listen, they actually took God up on his offer of come to me. And some of us complain about God a lot. Like, we'll just talk about things like, well, if God was real, then he never spoke to me. And if God was real, why didn't this happen? And I remember praying one time and asking God for a miracle and it didn't happen. And what about this and that? And you know what? God's okay with your complaints, but he would rather that you would say it to him face to face. Instead of talking about God, he's okay with your doubt, with your struggle, with whatever you're going through. But he just wants you to tell him. Because in those moments when you actually begin to talk to God about it, what he will do is he'll give you perspective. He'll begin to restore your soul. He can handle the verbal abuse that we want to give him. And he can actually begin to fix us and restore us and begin to work in our lives. Lord, help me. All right. I got you. I hear you. And he begins to work in our lives. Come on, God longs to quench the thirst in your soul. He longs for that. The most restorative thing is being with Jesus. So come to Jesus. Go directly to the source. That's my number one thought. Number two thought is this. Our soul's thirst is an opportunity for restoration. In other words, a lot of us think, well, I'm so broken on the inside that I shouldn't go to church. You ever felt that way? Like, especially if you made a what you might consider a big sin on a Saturday night, you're like, I ain't going to church. No, I need a couple of weeks. Like, as if that matters to God. But that's how we think, right? You know, you cuss somebody out or you do something bad, you're like, no. And the reality is that when your soul is in a spot of being parched, maybe that's a sign that God is the creator and he's infinite and you and I are finite and we're just out. So we got to go back to the infinite. Say, God, I ran out and I'm making a mess of things. Lord, help me. So your thirst is maybe an opportunity for God to do some restorative work in your life. I was reading this great book that I'd highly recommend. It's called Are You Fully Charged? It's by Tom Rath. He's the guy who did Strength Finders. It's a little leadership book. It's easy read. And he's writing from a place. He starts off his book saying, I was diagnosed with a terminally ill disease, and I decided I need to rearrange my life to spend the time doing the things that mattered. And so it began to reorganize, and he didn't want to spend his days feeling worn out and tired and exhausted. And so he found ways to physically and for his soul to be refreshed and come into work and into life with enough to give to his family and his children and things like that. And it's a great, great read, a great insightful book. And one of the things that they did a study on is they were talking about how we try to assuage our souls with things that numb the pain but don't really restore us. So sometimes we're worse off at the end than we were at the beginning. So have you ever noticed, like, late at night, if you get hungry and you skip dinner and you thought, I'm just going to wait till breakfast, but then you're like, no, I'm actually really hungry. You don't, and your body is craving nourishment. You're never like, you know, I would really like some basil leaves and tomatoes and some carrots right now. You're like, I need Dairy Queen. You know what I'm saying? And so when the hungrier we are, the thirstier we are, we tend to go for things that are less restorative and more nutritionally depleted, and they don't really make us feel good. I mean, they do for a minute. Let's not lie. Hello. But then in the end, it actually makes it worse for us. And so one of the studies in that book, University of North Carolina's Barbara Fredrickson, she said she did a study on the mindless things that people do to relax and how that motivates positive action in their life. And she ends up with this statement: empty positive emotions are about as good for you as adversity. In other words, if you just do things that kind of numb your way through, it doesn't help you. It helps you about the same amount as something bad. Because when bad things happen in your life, you have to do something with that. And it's an interesting thing. We actually look at things and go, well, I'm just going to do something to relax. But not all liquids are the same. This week I was had 2 days off in a row. And because I'm trying to practice what I preached, I took the first day to just as a Sabbath and really did no work around the house or anything, and watched the Apple keynote address all 2.5 hours, rewound a couple parts. kind of geeked out. It was awesome. And just kind of rested, prayed, read some Bible, and spent time with my family. And it was a wonderful day. The next day, I'm like, I'm packing in all the chores, getting it all done, and went after it. But in that day, I started off, and one of the things I wanted to do for the family was one of our bathrooms has a tub that has a seam, and it kind of gets grimy in there. So I took the blue Clorox gel bleach and squirted it in there and then let it sit. And then I was going to come back and scrub it out. And so I come back to scrub it out, and the little scrubber flung some bleach in my eye. And ladies and gentlemen, it hurt. Like it was, and I was glad nobody was home because I do tend to overreact. And I needed some time to get it back down to normal. But I'm squirting my eye with saline laying on the bed. Like four towels, like around my head, like this is disaster. And I'm like, oh, I'm going to die. You know, and I'm squirting this stuff and kept on my phone. And I'm reading articles to see what to do. And they all say the same thing. Rinse your eye for 15 to 20 minutes and then go to the doctor. I'm like, there's got to be an article about rinse your eye and don't go to the doctor. But I couldn't find one. So I go to the doctor and like, it was just, but my point is a really simple point is this. Not all liquids are the same. Some things are toxic for you. And some things are restorative for you. And we've got to put the right things in our life. There's an interesting study that came out, and I saw it in my news feed this week. And it's this, that millennials are actually drinking less alcohol by and large and by far compared to other generations, which is a great sign. And overall, alcohol consumption in America is on the decline. And what was interesting is this study, I have a news, a picture of it. It's called People Are Sick of Drinking, and so investors are betting on the sober curious. And so they're starting these pop-up bars in New York and in Brooklyn where you can go in and get a fancy drink with no alcohol. So people go in because they're aware that what they've been drinking actually causes them to make stupid decisions and things that can ruin their life for the next day or two, hurt them at work for the next couple of weeks, or ruin their life for weeks and months and years. And they're drinking because their soul is thirsty and they're wanting something different. And I just thought that's brilliant. Some of us in our Christian lives need to become sober curious about what it would be like to not fill my soul with all the stuff I've been filling with and go to the source of life, Jesus, and let him bring in what I need in my life. Come on, is this sinking in for somebody here today? Here's one of my favorite Bible verses, and I'm going to share it with you. God is speaking through Isaiah. Is anyone thirsty? Come and drink. Even if you have no money, come and take your choice of wine or milk. It's all free. Look, you might be thirsty in your soul and broke as a joke, but God is like, you can come and get what you need. Why spend your money on food that gives you no strength? And why pay for food that does you no good? Listen to me, and you'll eat what's good. You will enjoy the finest foods. God knows how to restore our soul. That word restore is in our English language, comes from French and Latin in the 1300s. And it means to put something back, and it means to stand something upright. And so literally the word stores, like a storefront, came after that, where the shelves would be stocked and secure upright. Things were put in place so that you could get what you needed. When God restores your soul, it's like he opens the cabinets of your world. And you might go, man, it's filled with some doubt or some real anger. But really, it's not those things aren't really there. It's that something that should be there is missing. And God goes, I'm going to put something back on the shelves of your soul. You feel shame and it's hard for you to even be in church because it's just stuff that's happened or you've done. And you just go, I don't even like being here because I feel so much shame. There's an empty spot in you where God's love and forgiveness should just be Costco-sized bottles stocked inside your soul. It should be full with all that God wants to put inside of you. When he restores our souls, he literally restocks joy, unconditional love, peace. He puts the things upright inside of the shelving of our life. So wonderful. The third and final thought as I wrap this up is that we need a regular drink. Like, you can't get by on just a little bit of Jesus a couple times a year. It's just not good enough. So I did some Apple clip art in Keynote, and here it is. I want to just tell you this quick story about the humans, camels, and bamboo. Okay, you all good with that? Humans, bambles, and camus. Oh my. Here's the thing about humans. Humans can only survive for about 3 days without water, and then they die. There's been a couple cases of 4 days and 5 days, but those are very rare. But typically, you're going to die after 3 days of no water. Just warning. Thanks for coming to church. On May 24th, you might have seen this story. On May 24th this year, a tough young woman was rescued from a Hawaiian mountainside, Amanda Eller. She survived 17 days in the steep mountainous jungle with a broken leg, severe sunburn, dehydration, and painful skin infections. Did anybody see this lady that got rescued? It's an incredible story. And when on this article, when it said painful skin infections, I'm like, I wonder if there's pictures. And I went online, and there are pictures. It's on the front of her shin, down by her ankle. It's nasty. And if you like that kind of stuff, you got to go check it out. Because, I mean, I'm just like, how, you know, anyway, if you don't like that, do not go there. But whatever restores your soul. Okay, so they asked her how she survived, and she survived because she was able to get to a waterfall, and she had a water source. So she survived for 17 days. Interestingly, there was another human being who was, the time of his missing was overlapping with Amanda Eller's, and he died. He did not have what he needed to survive, but she had water. Camels. Now, I never studied camels before in my life. Like, just, I don't know, have anybody studied camels? Right, like it's not a common thing, like, hey, you guys wanna go get coffee? And we're gonna study camels. Okay, awesome. But camels are actually kind of interesting. I knew that they could last for a while. In the winter seasons, when it's not incredibly hot in the desert, they can go several months without drinking, which is mind-blowing. But most of the time, they can go for several weeks without water. They can walk 100 miles without needing a drink. I walk to my car and I need a drink of water. 100 miles. And I'm like, wow. And the humps on their back, people think that's where the water goes. It's not. That's fat that their body metabolizes and stores as fat so that when they're hungry and thirsty, it begins to. And literally camels' humps will go down when they've gone without food and water. And then once they eat and drink again, the humps fill back up with fat. And a camel, this is fascinating. This is free. This isn't for church. This is just because you are allowing me to tell you this. But camels will drink 35 gallons of water in 13 minutes. I tried that the other day. I got bleach in my eye. It was amazing. One other non-important fact is that we have one word for camels. It's camel. But the Bedouins have 700 words for camels. Okay, that's all the facts about camels. But camels can go a long time. Bamboo. Bamboo. Can I get a bamboo? Okay, yeah, there you go. Bamboo. Chinese bamboo is interesting. If you were to plant Chinese bamboo in your backyard, you would be looking for it to come up out of the ground, and it won't in the first year. And so nothing happens. It's beginning to develop roots. But at the end of year two, you go out there, and there's nothing. Okay, but at the end of year three, you go out and check the bamboo. There's nothing above the ground. At the end of year four, there's nothing above the ground in the bamboo. And you start to go, I'm switching gears, and we're going to plant parsley or potatoes or something. And year five, the bamboo begins to grow above the ground. When it begins to grow, it'll grow 80 feet tall in 6 months. And they say that you can go out at night and you can hear the bamboo creeping and crackling as it's growing, which is disgusting. And it reminded me of some of the stories that Jesus talked about when he said the kingdom of God in our lives, it's like a tiny thing, but eventually it becomes the biggest thing. Now, that's amazing. One of the things about bamboo is bamboo needs water all the time. It thrives on water. That's why typically you see it in places like Asia or Japan, because there's so much rain and water there, or Portland. And this is it. Abby's basketball coach, they started doing a fundraiser, and they sold these T-shirts for the coming season. And so I think Abby put online, like, hey, if you want to buy one of the T-shirts to support my basketball team, you can. And so several different people did. And so some of the people at our church staff did. And so Chris Jordan had bought one. Lisa brings them in and is handing them out to the people who bought them that day. And Chris goes, Matt, what does the WTB stand for? And I'm like, I don't know. Maybe that's the brand, you know? And so I get home and go, Abby, what does the WTB stand for? And she goes, this is my coach's whole thing. It stands for water the bamboo. And so I go, okay, what does that mean? She said, well, so our coach gave us this. There's a picture of this jar with, this is not Chinese bamboo. This is a different kind of bamboo, but gave us this jar and every one of us had to take it home. And he tells a story about how the bamboo doesn't always grow quickly, but if you continue to water it, eventually it'll become what it was intended to become. And so after every game, a different kid took the bamboo plant home and had to put water on it. And so their phrase, even if they maybe had a rough practice or something, it's all right, we're watering the bamboo. And I just want to say this to you. This is a picture of their team in front of some actual bamboo to kind of give them vision for what it could become. But in your life, God designed you not to be a spiritual camel. He designed you to be more like bamboo. You need water on the regular. You need to not make Jesus something that you camel it. And you go, I'm going to go to church now, and I'm going to go pray, and I'm going to open up my Bible because it's, you know, Easter, and then I'm just going to, like, fill my tank and just walk 100 miles. You weren't designed for that. You were designed like bamboo to need an amount of water on a continual daily basis. And you go, well, I'm not seeing any growth. I'm telling you, water the bamboo. You're going to get there. I went to God one time and I prayed and he didn't restore my soul. How many times did you pray? I did it twice, 2 minutes each. All right, give God a couple more days, a little more faith than that. Come on, he can do the work in you. But we camel it and God calls us to bamboo it. Wow. So here's the question. It's the title of my message. And I want you to think about your life. What are you drinking? Like, what are you putting inside you when your soul is parched? Man, my heart as a pastor, if I could do one thing for everybody in New Vintage Church, it would be to get you individually to a spot where you daily spent time directly with Jesus. If I could do that, I know that Jesus could do so much in our lives. Listen, I feel like I'm Chinese bamboo in my life. Long process, a little bit of growth. Long process of watering, and then a little bit more growth. And I'm telling you that because if that's for me as a pastor, I just want you to know that maybe God's working in your life even when you're unaware. Maybe he's restoring your soul and wanting to, and he's just waiting and he wants us to do more. I'm going to give you three things to take home with you. If you want to restore your soul and let God give you rest and you want to find some rejuvenation, here's how you can do that. And I'm not going to teach these things. I'm going to tell you these things. Worship God. Don't just listen to Christian radio. Sing the song. Don't just watch the team. Open your mouth and begin to sing. Jesus, my... And begin to make it personal. Tell you something will happen when you're singing to him and not about him. Second thing is pray. When you pray to Jesus or to the Father in Jesus' name, however, you know, you want to phrase that, the Trinity... You can just come to God through the Holy Spirit, all of that. But when you come directly to God, what you're doing is you're saying, God, I'm going to put my cup under the fountain, and I want you to fill me up today. And you know, I don't know how to pray. None of us do. The way you pray, though, is don't think about prayer. Say the words out loud. The only bad prayer is when you don't pray it. Third thing is read the Bible. Some of you have substituted actually opening up the Bible app and reading for yourself, and you substitute that with a podcast or watching somebody else's sermon or reading other books. and go right to the source and let God water the bamboo in your soul through worship and prayer and reading your Bible. I brought this just to have some kind of a visual illustration today. This is my Star Wars mug. It means a lot to me. But it's empty, but it represents my life. And depending on how you grew up, I just want to clarify this is water. This represents God. He has more than enough supply for the cup of our life. Indulge me. Close your eyes. I want to pray that God would give you right now in this moment a drink of water for your own soul. That this would be a moment for you to open up the cup of your life, if you will. I'm going to read a scripture to you, but I want you to allow this to be a prayer for yourself. The Bible says on the last day of the climax of the festival, Jesus stood and he shouted out to the crowds, "Anyone who is thirsty may come to me. And anyone who believes in me may come and drink. Because the scriptures declare rivers of living water will flow from his heart." With everybody's eyes closed. I mean everybody's eyes closed. Everybody's eyes closed. If you just feel wherever your faith journey is with Jesus, it's to me is irrelevant on some level right now. I just want to know if you go, man, I feel parched and dry in my soul, and I know that I need Jesus directly, and I would like to be in on this prayer to allow him to touch me right here where I'm at. I want you to raise your hand, and we're going to pray together. This would be a beginning of a watering of the bamboo in your life. Father, you see all of these hands, and you know us, and you're the lover of our soul, and you care about us, and I'm praying that your spirit would just flood and quench. We look you in the face with our internal eyes, God, today. And we open up the cup and we open up the cupboards. We say, God, would you restock and restore? We want to come directly to you today. We ask you to restore our soul and give us rest. And God, we commit that we're going to do this again tomorrow. You put your hands down, but would you all keep your eyes closed? If you came into this building and this meeting today, but your life does not include Jesus in any way, and you go, man, I'm aware that I'm probably could use Jesus in my life. I'm telling you, you need him. He is the center of the universe. He's alive. He is God. He cares about you. And he would like to give you a brand new start inside your life. And he would like to restore your soul and begin that process. And he'd like to walk with you every single day of your life. If you have enough humility to do two things, one is to say, God, I know that I've blown it and I need your forgiveness. And number two, if you'll say, Jesus, I will follow you. I'll let you lead. And that kind of faith and that kind of attitude, God responds to. Jesus will step into your life. And I'd love to pray with you if you're on the very beginning of that journey of faith and you want to make Jesus King, Lord, President, like number one in your life. I'm going to pray with you today if you'd let me. You'll stay where you're at. Everybody's eyes are closed, but would you raise your hand if you say, I want to pray to start following Jesus. Come on, my friend. Thank you. Hold it up high so I don't miss anybody. Wonderful. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. It's wonderful. Put your hands down. We're going to pray as a family together. It's our tradition here, but it means a lot to us. And if you've raised your hand, I want you to pray these words with just so much faith. But the whole family, all of us, are going to say the words together. I'm going to lead, and you're going to repeat it back. Jesus, I'm coming to you. I'm coming to you in faith, believing in who you are, and I need you today. I'm asking you to step into my life. Please forgive every wrong I've done. give me a brand new start. I give you control of my life, and I'm going to let you lead, and it's going to start today, and it's going to be for the rest of time. Thank you for coming into my life. In Jesus' name, amen.